This is Nine News with Sophie Walsh.
Good morning. The Home Affairs Minister, Peter Dutton, has thrown a hand grenade into the coalition government, declaring former Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull offered him the deputy Liberal leadership when his grip on the top job was crumbling. Live 2 political reporter Chris O'Keefe in Canberra for us. Chris, stunning revelations from Mr. Dutton.
Well, a lot has happened in our country's political life, Sophie, since the dramatic events of last August. But still, there's fresh detail emerging over what happened in the lead-up and the fallout of Malcolm Turnbull losing the Prime Ministership. Now, Peter Dutton has revealed in a documentary with Sky News that he was offered the deputy leadership of the Liberal Party after the first party room vote, which Malcolm Turnbull only just won. Now, Mr. Dutton said Malcolm Turnbull wanted him to stay on as Home Affairs Minister, and when he refused, Mr. Turnbull offered him Julie Bishop's job as his deputy.
It's all, you know, pretty high-stakes discussions and a desire to see the best possible outcome. So, in my mind, an easy transition is always the best, but...
Is that what you were asking him to...
I thought that should have happened.
And you said that to him? You should stand aside.
He offered me the deputy leader position.
He offered you the deputy leadership?
Correct. And I said to him that this was just... Given what had just taken place, that wasn't credible. And it wasn't his to gift either.
Well, 3 days after the supposed offer, neither Mr. Turnbull or Mr. Dutton were victorious. Another vote was had and Scott Morrison came through the middle, and the rest, as they say, is history. One point to make, though, is the deputy leadership of the Liberal Party is voted on by the party room and not handed out by the Prime Minister. And Malcolm Turnbull denies that he ever offered the position to Mr. Dutton. Now, Scott Morrison also says that he genuinely believed at the time that Mr. Turnbull could have won them the election as Prime Minister. Peter Dutton says, well, he could have too.
All credit to Scott Morrison, because I think he has provided the leadership that Malcolm never could. So I think full credit to Scott Morrison. I only stuck my hand up last August because I believed that I could have won the election.
Now, given the coalition is still in power, Sophie, against all the odds, they must feel some way slightly vindicated.
Yes, indeed, Chris. Thank you. Police in Melbourne are trying to piece together how a man died in custody overnight. As Sam Cucciara reports, emergency services were called to the man's property just moments before his death.
Detectives are right now trying to work out exactly how a man died here overnight inside a home in Glen Waverley in Melbourne's southeast. He was in police custody at the time. Officers had been called to the property just before 8 o'clock. Following reports, this man was acting erratically. Police and paramedics were on scene when he passed away shortly after, appearing to have suffered some sort of medical episode. Despite the efforts of emergency crews, the man could not be revived. A post mortem examination will now be conducted. Many neighbours on this street have told me they didn't hear a thing, only waking in the middle of the night to the flashing emergency lights. As is standard practice in these sorts of incidents regarding deaths in police custody, this investigation will be handled by the Homicide Squad with oversights from the Victoria Police Professional Standards Command.
Police are hunting a man who stabbed an Adelaide nurse in the neck outside the Lyle McEwen Hospital last night. Police say she was approached by a man who asked for a cigarette around 6:30 p.m. He then stabbed her before running away. The victim is now in a stable condition. There's more shock for Mascot Towers residents in Sydney, with engineers warning the cracking building is actually sinking. Tiffany Genders has more.
Well, first it was the cracks. Now residents have been told this building is, quote, moving in a downward motion. Those who call Mascot Towers home received an email about this new issue last night. They were ordered to get down here today and move everything out as quickly as possible. For most, that meant calling in removalists, adding to the spiralling costs of this nightmare.
It's pretty scary, actually, but... I don't know how do they fix something like that, but that's why they're telling us to get our stuff out as quick as possible.
I've got to try and find money for a bond. I've got to try and find money for removalists. You know, when you're moving, you usually have time to save for this kind of thing, but it's like trying to pull money out of thin air. I can't afford it, but at the same time, don't have a choice.
We're just normal people trying to deal with a horrific circumstance, and we just need the government to, you know, basically give us as much help as possible.
It's been 11 days now since the apartment block was evacuated. Engineers have been visiting the site and discovered movement on the northern and eastern boundaries, so they've set up monitors to measure any further sinking. The Premier says this latest problem raises more concerns about what has been a serious issue from the get-go. The good news is money is starting to flow from the government's assistance package, which is helping people secure alternative accommodation. The question remains, though, who is at fault for all of this? When that becomes clear, residents are demanding they be held to account.
Tiff Genders reporting there. Well, dodgy builders responsible for flammable cladding could be in the firing line as part of a new Victorian government body combating the crisis. Premier Daniel Andrews says all avenues will be explored to ensure public safety.
If we can go after them to recover any or all of the costs involved, then you know, we don't rule out taking quite extraordinary steps to do that.
A task force investigating the issue is due to hand down a report soon before Cladding Safety Victoria is established. A man has died in hospital following a workplace accident in Sydney's West yesterday morning. 52-year-old Ian Martin became pinned between two trucks at the facility in Camellia. His employer, Just Skip Binns, say they are deeply saddened by his death and that he was a valued team member and great friend. Forensic specialists examined the scene and police will prepare a report for the coroner. Safe Work New South Wales is also investigating. There are fears we could be facing a new battle with measles, with reports Victorian patients have been struck down with the infectious disease despite already receiving the vaccine. 13 Victorians ended up in hospital with measles between 2014 and 2017 that already received one or two vaccinations. Scientists are concerned the way the disease spreads may have evolved. A very thankful family of 14 is safe after a fishing boat fire left them clinging to a tinny and waiting for rescue off the Queensland coast. Jess Millwood has the details.
This family of 14 are this morning recovering at home, all very thankful to be alive. In the words of rescuers, it's a miracle that no one was more seriously injured. The fishing charter was around 20 kilometres off the coast of Gladstone when it caught a light. Everyone jumped off, they evacuated and boarded a nearby tinny, but then that started taking on water. Life Flight were called out. They needed to airlift a 70-year-old man to hospital. He was suffering from hypothermia. Everyone else just clung to the tinny until they were rescued and brought back to shore. Here's what the skipper had to say.
Oh, we just sort of had to hit survival mode and bloody get off the boat as quick as we could. We had about 200-300 litres of unleaded on there, so we're waiting for the bang.
The family of 14 were on the fishing charter over the weekend to lift the spirits of one person who had recently been diagnosed with cancer. Investigations are now underway with Water Police involved as well as Maritime Safety Queensland to try and determine exactly what caused the blaze.
It's feared a heater could be to blame for a fire which gutted a Seaforth home this morning. Three men escaped with their dog shortly after 2 a.m. Fire crews helpless to save the property. There are concerns one of Victoria's largest coal-fired power stations could be shut down within 6 years. The Yallourn power station is due to close in 2032, but unions and industry figures fear it could close well before that and take with it 500 jobs. Adding to the panic, the Victorian government's 50% renewable energy target could bring the plant's end date forward. It provides more than 20% of Victoria's electricity, the equivalent of powering 2 million homes every day. The Australian Christian Lobby has launched a new fundraising page for Israel Folau, and it's already reached $500,000. It comes after his GoFundMe page was shut down as he tries to build a bank to fight Rugby Australia in court over his sacking. The crowdfunding giant said it would not support the promotion of discrimination. Oh, yeah.